2 raised to k factorial designs. So we'll talk about what are these designs, what are the models, how do you compute the effects, how do you do the variations, and then we go to, first we start actually with 2 raised to 2 designs, which is very simple, and then we go to 2 raised to k designs. So what is a 2 raised to 2 design? First of all, 2 raised to k design means you have k factors each at 2 levels. So you might have, like in the example that we're talking about, you might have 2 CPUs, 2 workloads, 2 users, so on and so forth. So there are many of such list, and those are, each of them is a factor, but each of them has only two values. Yeah.
So this can be only
categorical? Right now we are just talking about the categorical only, yeah. Yeah. So the question is, what about continuous? So we already talked about continuous. Continuous is all regression. Alright? So now we are going to talk about categorical, and then in the real world you will have a combination of these. Some categorical, some this one. But for the next few chapters, just assume everything is categorical.
And has only 2 options.
Eh?
And also only 2 options.
Oh, for this chapter?
Yes.
No, then we come to the multiple levels in the other chapter. First, I have to start with something simple. Thing is, we have to start with simple linear regression before we got into, you know, all this transformation and other things. Same thing here. Experimental design, I want to start with something simple that you can understand. So we are talking about 2 raised to k design. And this is not the only design. There are 4 or 5 chapters to go. So helps in starting out the impact of the factors. This is good at the beginning of a study. So when you start a study, 2 raised to k designs are good, because then you just do 2 extremes. Valid only if the effect is unidirectional. So if you know that the effect is unidirectional, as opposed to if it is like this, then you are going to miss conclusion, because you are saying, you will say that the effect is very small when it could be very large. Alright? So if it is unidirectional, then 2 raised to k designs are good. In this case, you really need 3 levels minimum. One here, one there, maybe. So here is a design. Here is an basically in some sense example that we measured the performance in MIPS for 2 memory sizes and 2 cache sizes. Alright, and now we are going to have 2 variables. XA is -1 if this is the memory, and +1 if this is the memory. XB is -1 if this is the cache size, and +1 if this is the cache size. Now we could do a simple regression just like we did before, and have the model which says y is equal to q0, qa, qb, qab, and qa, qb, and all that, like that, like that. We write down the 4 equations. 15 is equal to whatever the value of a and b, xa and xb are, and 45 equal to 25 equal to so on and so forth. And we can solve these 4 equations for 4 unknowns. Straightforward. 4 equations and 4 unknowns. And you will get that q0 is 40, and QA is 20, and so you will get that y is equal to 40 plus 20 XA plus 10 XB plus 5 XA XB. Alright, so how do you interpret this model? This model says that the mean performance is 40. But if you choose XA, depending upon the XA, the performance could go up by 20 or down by 20. If XA is +1, it is +20. If it is XA -1, -20. So the effect of memory is 20. Cache size has other effect. If it is +1, it is +10. If it is -1, it is -10. So the effect of cache is 10 MIPS. And then XA, XB, depending upon what the memory size and what the cache size is, the performance could be +5 or -5. Alright, So the interaction between memory and cache is 5. So now you see the interaction. Basically, this is the effect of A, this is the effect of B, this is the interaction A and B. This is the mean value. Okay? Alright, now the thing is that how did I solve those equations? I mean, you can solve those equations, it's not a very difficult thing by subtracting, adding, but there's a simpler method. It's a tabular method, is that you write down a table in which you write down A, B, and you start with 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, whatever we do in binary table, but instead of 0, just write a minus 1. So minus 1, minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, minus 1, 1, and 1, 1. Write down the Y values in that order, and then solve the equations. Actually, the equations will come out like this, but better for me to go through an example and tell you how to do this thing. Let me just go through an example. Is that you write down a table with A, B, as we said, and but add two more columns. An I column, which is identity column, write all ones, and a product column, AB column, which you write the product of the two terms. Now you write down the Y column. Now each column you take with the vector. You just take this I vector and the Y vector, multiply them and add the sum. So that this is 160 is basically 1 times 15 plus 1 times 45 plus 1 times 25 plus 1 times 75 is 160. Then you do the A column and the Y column, minus 1 times 15, plus 1 times 45, minus 1 times 25, plus 1 times 75, you get 80, and so on and so forth. How do you get I? Mm-hmm. I is all ones.
All ones. And I is multiplication?
AB is the product of A and B. Alright? Then you divide, because you take taken the four rows here, divide by four, then you get this mean of that column. Alright? Those are the effects. 40 is the mean, effect of A is 20, effect of B is 10, effect of interaction A and B is 5. Okay.
How
do you get the total? Mm-hmm. You mean this total line?
Yeah.
This is just the sum of the product. Okay. One more time. You take this vector, multiply with this vector, that comes out to 160. Take this vector and that vector, sum comes out to 80. Everybody is clear as to how we are getting all these numbers? I mean, you can do it in Excel very easily. But now we talk about the variation. So we have to do SST, SSE, SSR, all those things, right? So let's do that. So the variation, the variance is, we know y bar minus y I minus y bar whole square. In this case, there are only four values. So we can just do that and divide it by 3, because y bar was estimated from the same values. So 1 degree of freedom we lost. So you can, so that is your total variation without, before the model. And it turns out after the model there is no variation left, because there is no error in this model, by the way. As you will see, notice in a minute. So basically the total variation is equal to, and you can, I mean, we can prove that mathematically, is equal to 4 times QA square plus 4 times QB square plus 4 times QAB square. So we are saying that this part is explained by the A, this part is explained by the B, this part is explained by the interaction. So we call this SSA, we call this SSB, we call this SSAB. So SSAB is simply 4 times QAB square, where QAB is this value here, 5. SSA is 4 times QA square, where QA is this value, 20 right there. Those are the effects. So the fraction of explained by A is SSA upon SST. So the A effects explains this fraction of the variation. Now remember, I am going to use the word variation, not variance, because variance was that, but variation is this part. Right? Variation does not have that denominator. All right. So the derivation is actually straightforward. I don't know whether I really need to go through the derivation here in the class. But one of the things that helps here is that the way we wrote down these columns, instead of adding 0 and 1, we wrote down minus 1 and plus 1. So all the columns add up to 0 except for the I. So this A column adds up to 0, B columns adds up to 0, AB column adds up to 0. Right? So XAI is 0, XBI sum is 0, XABI sum is 0. And another property is that sum of all the squares of all the columns is 4, which is clear because we have only ones there. When you square them and add them, you get 4. If you use those two properties, and then the product of each column is, product of any two columns is 0. That's another interesting property. If you take A and multiply it by AB and you add them up, you will get a 0. If you take A and multiply by B and add them up, you will get a 0. You take B and AB, it will be 0. So they're all orthogonal. Alright? And so the products are all 0. So basically, when you take by I and when you sum it up, you get an equation which says sum of by I will be equal to Q0. Everything else will cancel out. When you take by I minus by R square, everything else will cancel out. Only thing will be left is QA square, QB square, and QAB square, 4 times each of them. Everything else cancels out because all the product terms are 0. So anyway, in the memory case study, we can say that this total variation, which was 2100, can be divided into 3 parts. First part is this, second part is that, and third part is this. And first part is 76% can be explained by memory, 20% can be explained by cache, and 5% is due to interaction. So what that says is, if you really wanted to optimize this variable, which is the performance in MIPS, the first thing you really need to work on is the memory. Because memory really gives you the best change. Then you worry about the cache. And then worry about the interaction. Now, in a practical sense, I would say that I would not worry about this interaction. We'll say, okay, all right, this is there, but this is small, 5%. Cache is kind of expensive, so it's good that it doesn't have that much effect, so I'm not going to worry about the cache. If I want to improve the performance of my computer, I would go and buy more memory, if this data were true. Right? Memory is cheap and has more effect. Is something missing? Alright, so I'm going to leave right there, 15 slide. Any questions about this interpretation? So you learned, actually I wish I had an exercise here so you could do the homework, but there is no homework. So, you might as well read it in the book and do some exercises. But basically it's very simple. You have 4 values measured. You get 4 parameters out of it, Q0, QA, QB, and QAB. And then you can divide the variation into 3 parts at least. And then you can say what is the variation due to A, what is the variation due to B, and what is the variation due to AB. Yeah, go ahead.
For some reason, I don't see that just as an experimental design now, you can actually focus on what's important from your system. You get more data from this.
Yeah, right. So the thing is, now you know what is important. So the thing is, it's quite possible that in your next set of experiments, you will not even worry about cache. You will just worry about 80% and see what is the effect of memory. Is it linear or is it non-linear or what it is? Because that is what you really need to understand. Right? But right now we got 2 extremes. The 2-level design, all you get is 2 extremes. So you know that this point and this point are 80% away. Now you need to worry about exploring that space between those two.
So this is the first phase that you're talking about?
Yes, this is the first phase we're talking about.
Yeah. Is it possible for the variation due to interaction to change as you change?
Oh yeah, of course, anything. See, the thing is, these are very point results. I mean, there are many other things we'll talk about in a minute. I mean, not in a minute, in the next few chapters, where we will talk about what is the advantage of replication, what is the advantage of more than two levels, and so, I mean, this is just four experiments we did, and we didn't do any replication. It's quite possible that these values have a lot of randomness in themselves. Right? So there are more complicated stuff coming in. But first thing you notice is that now, with given the same data, people would have made, you know, some statements from this data, but they would not have said that memory is really 80% effect. Now you can make that statement.
I assume that you have to use set of experiments to define it. I mean, you just wrote 15 as a first value, but this 15 is according to a set of experiments, right? It's not just a single experiment.
No, right now, let's say single experiment. So replication will come later. So you think if suppose 15 was the average of 5, then we would say then there is a 2 raised to k R design. R is the number of replications, which is another design which is coming up.
I want to repeat the question.
Yeah.
How do you know that it's 15?
Oh, you measured it. You just measured it once and they came out 15. You measured it once.
So you measured with 1K and 4 megabytes memory instead of count 15?
Is one experiment is enough to...
No, it's not. But at least, you know, I'm just saying that with one experiment, this is the information you got. And this is the conclusion you made. In the next chapter, we'll talk about 2 raised to k R design. So we'll say, what is it that if you do more than one replication? Right? So, but we are not talking replication right now.
And
okay?
And you also don't know that it's unidirectional from this experiment.
Yeah, that has to come from system knowledge. See, the thing is, there are two ways to get that, whether it is unidirectional or, you know, bimodal or, you know, parabolic or whatever it is. You have to somehow get it from the system knowledge, or, you know, just you have to do a lot more than two levels then.